guys, I'm Dr. Kim Sage. Welcome to my YouTube channel. If you are just joining me, this channel is all about mental health and attachment and relationships and trauma and childhood trauma and hopefully some other things that will help you heal your story and your journey. So please consider subscribing and clicking the bell if you'd like to join this little growing community, and that way you'll get notified when I post new videos. Okay, so this video is really about the signs you were raised by a narcissistic parent. It is part of my Mama and Papa Trauma series, and I really do believe that we have this sort of combination of genetics and environment that really do affect, you know, how we end up expressing the stories of our childhoods, whether we manage it well or don't, where we struggle, where we don't, our strengths and resilience as much as our struggles and our difficulties. And so this video will really be exploring how having a narcissistic parent may impact you today. Now, narcissism is a very trending topic, and it almost makes me hesitant to talk about it because there are some great discussions about it. But I do find it very fascinating that even the research that we now know that borderline, let's say, and antisocial PD do also have some strong biological components, we're still sorting out whether or not narcissism does too. And I think it makes sense that it will when it does. There are some very, you know, early studies talking about the fact that there are some brain abnormalities in those with narcissism. And so there really is this emerging research that we still don't know enough about, but we are becoming a more self-focused society and world. And so whether you watch this video as an older person who was raised by parents with narcissism, or you're someone younger and someday you want to have a family, I think it's really important to understand sort of where you come from and how it can play out in your story with your kids, right? So this will help you at the end, hopefully, get some more compassion and understanding for yourself. Now, of course, it matters in some regards. It can, you know, was the parent with NPD, let's say, for example, the primary parent, let's say a mother versus a father, or versus who had the primary role, and or your gender, it's really hard to know because all of us have different thresholds of stress and are impacted in different ways. And we don't yet really know, you know, exactly what causes this or the other thing. We do tend to believe it's a number of factors that can make a difference. So keep that in mind as we go through it. Now, remember too that the hallmarks of narcissism really are lack of empathy, lack of attunement, you know, gaslighting in a parent, basically telling you that your reality is not your reality, a difficulty really mirroring you and attuning to you. We often can see rage and or, you know, sort of a difficulty navigating anger. You often are a projection of them in terms of your value. And so, you know, your achievement is their achievement. It's often very goal-oriented. It often feels very, you know, one-sided, right? Even if the NPD parent is a victim type narcissist, right? They're all that covert narcissist. No matter what, it's like there's a mirror and there's only one person in it, and it's the parent who has this disorder. There's not a reflection going back and forth, a real live back and forth, I should say, as opposed to, it's just a mirror of the parent. And so you're really going to feel that as a kid. And so as a result, you're going to have sort of a number of issues, including things around, let's say, setting boundaries, how you deal with conflict. At the root of it, most of those raised by parents with this disorder are going to have some level of difficulty around self-esteem and self-worth, lovability, value, and things like that, right? Oftentimes a deep sense of shame, and I'll discuss that in a minute. So keep those in mind. Now, as I talk about in a lot of my videos, I think, let's say for BPD versus NPD, often those with borderline do, you know, they do want to be in a relationship. And so they will attempt to mirror and attune. And I guess you could argue, well, can they really? But I really do believe that you get more of that complicated, confusing good love, bad love. And I would say those people raised by borderlines often described really conflicting emotions, really strong feelings at times of hate and anger towards the parent, but also love and guilt. And you could also argue that oftentimes borderlines, you know, unintentionally raise their children to take care of them emotionally. And so there is always been this wiring to feel responsible for them. I don't think that's so much the case in narcissism. I do think that the parent makes the child feel responsible for them in terms of, you know, there's not a reciprocity there. But I think that I generally see a lot more conflicting emotions because of that confluence and that back and forth of good love and bad love that's more common. Where with narcissism, you just tend to get more of that one-way love, right? It's very conditional love. And so you don't often feel attuned to or mirrored or, you know, empathized with really at all. And it's sort of my way or the highway in general with narcissists. So what do we see? Let's just go through, I think, what the top issues are. As a result of never really being validated, and that is the hallmark of narcissism, is that a lack of validation, right? We call it highly invalidating environments. That often lines up really nicely with avoidant attachment, you know, type parents, because avoidant attachment often has a very conditional type love. It's a very achievement type love. It's often the child deactivates, they stop needing the parent the same way, and they often become auto-regulators. They take care of their own needs. They become very autonomous, independent. Oh, you know, look at Cameron, you know, he's playing by himself at two. It's like, yeah, because he kind of had to. He could play near you, but not play with you, right? And it's often the case that those with this type of childhood, I find with avoidant, and the research supports this, often have very poor memory around childhood. They have not good, you know, memories around, well, if I say, for example, well, you know, what kind of childhood did you have? What were your parents like? They'll say, oh, they were pretty good. You know, my mom was loving and caring, or my dad was there. And I say, okay, well, can you give me some examples of those stories? And they go, yeah, I can't really think of any right now, but I know they were there. I know they were, you know, they took care of us, but they oftentimes struggle. And the research does support that there are some memory issues in terms of how memory is encoded with this attachment style, which is another whole conversation. Check out this video if you want to look at avoidant attachment. But you should know that it is a thing. That's kind of what happens. And so I think with narcissism, it's very much the case. So keeping all that in mind, right, we often find that with, you know, those with these kind of childhoods, they walk around the world never really feeling seen and heard and validated by others or themselves. It's almost like they feel like at their core, they don't matter. And that plays out in how they see themselves. And so they're always looking for that, but always really at the end of the day, feeling like they don't matter, like they aren't seen or heard. Number two is that they often feel only worthy when they are doing. These are that classic, we are human doings, not human beings. Whether it's how they look, how they dress, their achievements, their school, their soccer performance, their sports, their talent, right? It's always about doing. Doing gives them worthiness, not just being valued for who they are as good, loving, kind human beings. They see themselves in black or white terms. I'm either successful because I'm an extension of my parent and I'm achieving, or I'm nothing. And so that's another issue for them. The next one is they often have a hard time identifying and trusting their own emotions. And this really goes back to that avoidant attachment, where because they had to shut down their attachment needs, we do find that they have a hard time identifying emotions sometimes. And so in that regard, the parent who doesn't attune or mirror them really reinforces the fact that they're not seen or heard. And so they can oftentimes not even really be able to identify. If I say, well, how do you feel about that? They'll say, well, I don't know. Like, am I supposed to know? Or don't you know what I feel about that? Shouldn't you know? Or they'll say, I think. Well, I think they get very cerebral, right? They have a hard time connecting to emotion. Number four is they're often very much externally focused, right? So that's part of what the narcissist tells them, is that it only matters if the world sees it or I see it. And as a result, they try to manage that by becoming perfectionists and oftentimes very self-critical and very harshly critical to others. And so they have a very harsh lens on themselves and everyone else. And they'll admit it in sessions, saying, God, I'm really like, you know, I'm really judgy of others. But they're at the worst, they're the most judgy of themselves. And that really is that attempt to mitigate the impacts of the narcissistic parent, you know, getting to them first, making them feel bad about themselves. If they can criticize themselves first and or correct everything and make it look perfect, they might somehow get the love or the mirroring that they so deeply desire. The next one I often find is they're often not only in denial about their childhood stories, but they often will be very secretive. And if you ask for details to understand their story, it's hard to get real data from them. And I think it's because they struggle, like I said in the beginning, but they often tend to be more secretive and protective of the family system, oftentimes without even realizing it. Of course, they tend to struggle with self-esteem and knowing who they are, and oftentimes struggle with knowing, you know, where their meaning or value is derived from if it's not from external things. And so their self-esteem is often, as I said, very low. Next one is, like I said earlier too, that often that emotions are unsafe for them. And so they can't identify them. They have a hard time not only expressing them to you, but with themselves. And as a result, they often numb out by shopping, by addictions, you know, by just putting their emotions like in a little box somewhere, right? They have a really hard time integrating their feelings. And so when they do feel something, they tend to want to extinguish it as soon as possible because that makes them vulnerable. And vulnerability is not a good thing to have with a narcissist. It keeps you very unsafe and very, you know, easily wounded. Along those lines, they often don't trust others, of course, because they didn't learn trust in a very safely validating way at home. And they're often very suspicious of others' intentions. So they're often assuming that everybody else is going to, you know, manipulate them or take from them or eventually hurt them. And they often, as a result, build this wall to protect themselves from that. But at the core, there's no real true trust in others', you know, intentions and abilities to be there for them. The next one is they're often highly sensitive to feedback or criticism at all. Oftentimes, criticism is a narcissist's favorite tool, right? They're very critical, they're very sharply focused, oftentimes successful, good problem solvers. And so the children often feel that any kind of feedback is criticism. And so they oftentimes will struggle. Even if it's like a work feedback situation, they often feel it so intensely, it feels like piercing needles to have any feedback, that either they can't handle it and become easily wounded, or it keeps them from even making any efforts to take risk in the world. The next one is they often struggle with boundary setting and keeping, right? Whether it's respecting yours because they didn't have it modeled, so they have a poor understanding of boundaries, and or they really struggle to set their own boundaries. Narcissists are the worst at, whether it's like, you know, taking what they think is theirs, eating off your plate, inserting themselves into situations that don't involve them. And so kids with parents like this, either they're like super dismissing of boundaries, or they can't set them, or they blow past them, right? And so that's an issue. And the next one is you often find those raised by those with NPD to be very strong caretakers and people pleasers. That's all of that attempt to kind of like rotate around the parent. And that might be also more of an anxious parent dynamic too. Let's say dad was an avoidant narcissist and mom was a more anxious type character situation. They might also develop those sort of hypervigilance qualities, watching mom kind of rotate around dad. But the core of it is that there's often this tendency to sort of, you know, please everybody else, and then I will also be valuable, because the root of the narcissistic, you know, rule is that you are an extension of me. And so your value comes from what I decide is worthy of value. And so that attempt to get your needs met often, you know, plays out in people pleasing and caretaking. The last couple ones, there's so many, but the last couple ones I think that, like I said in the beginning, is that you often, when you have this kind of parent at your core, it depends on how much of an impact, right? But you often feel deeply unlovable, deeply ashamed, and deeply unworthy. And it doesn't matter if you are at the top of your game, you often feel like an imposter, like it's not really true, and or you can never seem to get the, you know, agency to change your life. You're always just trying to get there because at the core, you don't believe in yourself. You're never enough. You're not worthy. And that really is the hallmark of this type of parenting. And lastly, I would say that if you tend to have, and this kind of goes with all of these issues, is that you probably have more, you know, issues with anxiety, depression, self-esteem, substance abuse, mental health, and possibly physical health as well. Perhaps you navigated the mental health part well, but it comes out in your body. And so your risk for chronic illness, like I talk about a lot in CPTSD, is higher. You have, you know, RA or fibromyalgia or diabetes. Whatever it is, you tend to have a higher risk because oftentimes, of course, depends on a lot of factors, but the severity of these repeated interpersonal complex traumas are a repeated disregard of you as a human being. And so that is going to play out for many people, not for everyone, but for many people in their body sometimes, right? They don't feel like they're struggling up here in their mind, but it comes out in chronic illness or pain or difficulty or accidents. It could be all kinds of things. So you probably have some level of increased, you know, difficulty in that regard if you had a parent like this. So those are what I think the top issues are. Oh, I forgot one more, which is obviously an issue with conflict or rage. If you had a parent who either avoided, was very like victim-y and sort of their, you know, more covert type of narcissism, or they were very rage-directed, that you may have a really hard time dealing with other people's anger and emotions, especially anger, and how to balance that. So it's either passive aggressiveness, or it's direct conflict, you avoid, and or you have taken on some of those narcissistic traits and become very aggressive yourself. And so you don't know how to navigate. It's like 0 to 60, you know, really, really either way. So Those, what I would say, are the main signs, I think, of growing up with a parent like this. Obviously, it really, you know, it's so individual, but I think it's an important topic. As I said in the beginning, I really think that with a parent who struggles with NPD, it's very different from other disorders because you do really, truly lack the empathy and mirroring and attunement. And the root of it, though many of these tie back to feeling unworthy and unloved, there's a certain thing that happens with narcissism where it's like, you just don't matter at all. And I think you get more of that in some other disorders because, like, say for BPD, there is often the desire for a relationship. And so you just may not get that consistently, but you get it sometimes. And of course, that's oftentimes very flawed and a wounding part of it. But I think with NPD, you really do feel that sense of like, well, do I even matter? Thanks for watching. Please stay safe and well. Don't forget to subscribe and click the bell. And I'll see you guys next time. Take care. Bye.